Some of you are already there in the last March, and many new people I'm seeing today who were not there in the last March. So after the last March, several months passed and we were not doing anything, and then we thought, let's have some kind of follow-up activity. And then starting January, every second Saturday, we have what are called curiosity circle meetings. So in a curiosity circle, we invite one or two speakers to pick a particular topic so that we can sort of broaden the perspective of understanding what is this thing called science, I mean, and what are the important things that, and how do we engage continuously on an ongoing basis. So we had the inaugural talk by Professor Lamy, who is here with us, and then we had a talk from Professor Vidita Vaidya on the history of neurobiology. And the third talk was delivered by me on the history of complex systems and its relevance in understanding this world. And then, it interestingly happened, we say that today is actually the curiosity circle second Saturday. So, and of course we had this nice opportunity so that we don't have any specific talk, but all of us are actually marching for this year, and that is one of the important things. So remember and mark in your calendar, every second Saturday is our, we can call it March for Science Day or Curiosity Circle Day or whatever it is, we're going to continue this engagement. And please invite us to various other places, because you know we had these meetings. We started at Obi Baba Center, the second meeting took place at Sophia College, and the third one took place at CBS in Kalina, Mumbai University. And actually what happened, just immediately a week later, there was another talk that was held at IIT by the Science Technology Society group. And then we are having this meeting today, which is actually the fifth meeting in this year. And also the sixth meeting, the day we call it here, second Saturday in May. So the speaker will be announced, you know, so all of you please continue contacting and be in touch. Having said that, I would like to point out certain important things, like, I mean, both Vivek and Jayaraman has already given you the bigger context. And there is also one more bigger context that we also have to keep in mind, which is that, you know, when, for example, the interesting discoveries and inventions took place in the West, there was a reaction in the society. All of you know that. For example, the people who were burnt at the stake, you heard about those examples. For saying that, you know, the earth is not the center of the universe, but sun was. And then, and that kind of upheavals whenever they happened, and also when evolution theory was there, there was a reaction in the society. For one interesting reason, and that is because that was a kind of an engaging culture where, you know, people are not just willing to hear an idea and just follow it. And keeping that in mind, today I somehow feel that we are in a fortunate situation in India, because there are people who are responding to some of the scientific ideas. It didn't happen in the past, and it's increasingly happening now in a big way. And also because they have some kind of a place and a platform, and so we are hearing more of those voices nowadays. And we heard about plastic surgery, we heard about problems in evolution and things like that. And one of the interesting ways in which these people and these attacks actually come is from a fragmentation point of view. They don't mind accepting technology. They use technology left, right, and center. That's very interesting. And they don't mind nuclear science. Why? Because they'll get an atomic bomb out of it. Okay, so they will support that. But they don't realize that the support for evolution actually has come from nuclear science. Because radioactivity gave the strongest support for the idea of evolution. So this actually is an interesting way of looking at it, because you know the idea of the people who are anti-science are trying to fragment technology from science, and also the various branches of science as well. Say that we are okay with medicine, but not with biology, not with evolution. In fact, none of the medicines would work today. If you haven't used a simple model organisms, which is a mice, which is a guinea pig, which is a bacteria, which is some other drosophila, so that is where all the research was happening. And we apply the drugs in those organisms, and then we do the medicine drink, which essentially means that the foundation of medicine also is evolution. Because if you don't believe that there is a unified idea that all the living organisms are following the same principles, medicine shouldn't work. So therefore, it is very important that we have to realize this comprehensive picture that the truth in science holds only in combination with other true facts as well. That means there is a coherence of thoughts. And all these ideas come together, and you don't come in partitions, or they don't come to us in division. And that is a very important thing. It is not the case that, no, I will be very happy with mathematics, but I won't accept any other thing. It's not going to work. Because mathematics gave us a very strong support to almost all the scientific ideas that we are doing. And that is also the same case with whether it is chemistry or whether it is any other subject. No subject can be held in isolation. And science is one global worldview. And there is a coherence in that. And the arguments and the methodologies that we use are also coming from multiple quarters, and everybody has to learn from one to the other. In fact, today, even mathematics is transforming itself in a big way. They're also learning a lot from the various ways in which, why is it that biological part is not applicable to mathematics, or why is it that some particular mathematical model cannot be applied to mathematics, to biology. And in that whole process, things are sort of transforming today. We can't hold at the same time that social sciences are not sciences. You know, we know very well that social sciences also come on a very strong pedestal of coming out with its own methodology, which is sufficiently systematic and very authentic. And therefore, you know, whether it is economics, whether it is anthropology, whether it is psychology or cognitive science or whatever, you know, there is a common global perspective that is emerging. So it is not that, you know, we should be only marching with the physicists, biologists, and chemists. We also have to march with social scientists as well. And that is when, you know, we'll be in a position to take up this kind of a unified perspective and start marching this idea. So let us convert this bad time into an opportunity for us. Because there are people, there is a possibility of a dialogue, there is a possibility of a discussion, there is a possibility for an engagement, and that is what we should use this opportunity. So while we are protesting, we should also be celebrating the success of science. And in fact, it's quite ironical that, you know, there are so many articles and so many films have been made about the phenomenal success of science. And today, some portions of science, they thought, are isolated and they can be attacked. Yeah. And so it is for us to, you know, defend this culture as a unified global worldview, and making sure that the pyramid of the practitioners and the participants of science expand to a larger. People keep asking this question, for example, why aren't there Nobel Prize winners in India? Or why is it that, you know, science is actually Western? We are not actually dealing with Indian science here. You know, that's another kind of thing that we keep hearing. You know? There is a Muslim science, there is a Indian science, and then there is some other science and things like that. One, of course, the current history of science very clearly demonstrates that the current science is actually has a multicultural roots. The roots of current modern science are there in India, are from China, as well as from the Arabian science, as well as from the Greeks. So these four cultures, we have very good idea and understanding of how they contributed, and the roots of the modern understanding actually came. Of course, revolutions are singularities; they happen, they don't happen everywhere. So happened that, you know, the Western science cultivated it, but not so. Accidental reasons. There are also other important points that one needs to keep in mind in terms of the cultural practices the society in general had. And so we have to also consider this point that science education, because I work in a science education organization, we also have to have, for example, a lab in every school and college. Laboratory facilities will exist in every school and college. You know, today, cricket is played all over the country. Football is played in Mizoram and Goa and several other places. And if you go and tell them, you know, from today onwards, the government of India has decided that, you know, cricket won't be played in the schools. It is like that. The reaction to cricket will be so strong if that happens. Of course, nobody will take that stupid decision. The only reason being that the base of the pyramid of cricket is very strong in the country. Everybody plays cricket. It is played in the street. Whether you have a lab or not, that is whether you have a wicket or not, whether you have a bat or not, whether you have a cricket ball or not, people use whatever fatta is available. They do the fatta cricket and fatta football everywhere. And that is the way we have to play science. We have to have science labs in every corner of the street and every village, every place. And that is when, you know, we'll be able to produce. So the excellence will come only when there is equity. And so the base of the pyramid has to be strong. So let us carry this message as part of this March for Science, and we'll go forward. As we have already understood, as it is also the practice of the March for Science, this is a silent march. I think all of us understand this. So we are basically going to display whatever you want to display, and walk silently from here to the Haji Ali, and that's where the place we are going to disperse. We are not going to have another congregation or a meeting at that place. That is one of the reasons why we thought we'll actually have some time to talk to. So don't forget the second Saturday meetings, the curiosity circle meetings, and anything else?
No, so by the way, I've just got. Nehru Planetarium was a bit upset because we told them there'd be X and we've already fitted in way more people here than the safety and security allows them to. So they are very, very antsy. There are a lot of people waiting outside and they've not allowed them in. Okay. So I think we should go outside. Yes. We can continue talking to them outside if you want. Guys, peaceful, peaceful. Please do not go out carrying your banners like this. Let's not make it appear that we are protesting against Nehru Planetarium. Okay. So we have lots of placards.